Hi, this is Inky35, and I just thought today that I would put up some Marduk and Yahweh comparisons, and this is what people call him, but the name Yahweh also coincides with another god named Yahweh. That's actually the Canaanites' god, and he is the son of El, which is married to a goddess called Asherah. I'm not going to get into that, but I just want people to realize that the Yahweh that most people don't recognize is the Yahweh of the son, that he's the son of Enlil. Enlil is El. Enlil is the Lord of the Wind. He is the Lord of the Command. And he is also known to have drawn his lot or cast his lot for the earth. And because he was cast and his lot was cast, he became the ruler of the earth. So Enlil is the prince of the air. Now, his son is Yahweh. And Yahweh is married to Asherah. So these are his children. Ishtar is Inanna. Ashtoreth is Inanna. But what I'm going to do here is I'm going to compare the ancient Near Eastern high gods and supreme gods. And I'm going to go ahead and show what gifts were bestowed upon the gods. And this is a comparison with the ancient Mesopotamian gods, which has to do with Marduk and the Hebrew god. So keep in mind that the ancient Enuma Elish was written in 2350 BC, and that the Bible was written over 1,000 years later. So everyone needs to remember that this is a more ancient tale, and the parallel of what it states in the Bible actually parallels with the Enuma Elish, the creation epic. And these are called the seven tablets of creation, and it's talking about Marduk. So in Enuma Elish tablet 5 verse 141 and tablet 7 verse 14, it states that he, Marduk, shall be the lord of all the gods, and no one among the gods shall make himself equal to him. And then we have the Hebrew Psalms 135:5 and 136:2 and 3, that it states that our God is above all gods, God of gods, and Lord of Lords. And right here in these verses, the God of all the gods in the ancient older text is called Marduk, and he is called the Lugal Dimmer Ankia, the divine king of heaven and earth. So it states in Enuma Elish tablet 7 16 83 89 and 135, it says that he, Marduk, established the holy heavens, creator of the earth above the waters, establisher of things on high, who made the world's regions. He created places and fashioned the netherworld, which means that he created the above and the below. And in Hebrews, in the Hebrews Bible, in Proverbs 8:27-28, it states, God established the heavens, inscribed a circle on the face of the deep, and made firm the skies above, marked out the foundations of the earth. And in Psalms 136:6, it states, God stretched out the earth above the waters. So, right here is another comparison of the creation in the Enuma Elish, the seven tablets. So here we have again, in Enuma Elish, tablet 5, 3, 5, 8, 12 through 13, and 23, 44, and 46. In tablet 5 of the Enuma Elish, it states that he, Marduk, patterned the days of the year, established the positions of Anlil and Ea, made the moon appear, entrusted to him the night, assigned to the crown jewel of nighttime to mark the day of the month. Marduk defined the celestial signs for religious festivals, the door bolt of sunrise, the watches of night and day. And here we have in Genesis 1:14, 16 through 17, in the Bible it states, God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons. The literal Hebrew means religious festivals, as used elsewhere in the Pentateuch. And it states, and for days and years, and God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also, and God set them in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth. And that's Genesis. Here in the Enuma Elish, tablet 6, and 33, and 129, and tablet 7, 89, it states, he, Marduk, made mankind, creatures with the breath of life, creator of all people. And it states in Genesis 2, 7, that God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. What people have a hard time understanding about these ancients of days is that there are several gods called the Elohim in Hebrew, and they are also called the Anunnaki or Anunnagi. And some people think that this word Anunnaki was a made-up word by an author by the name of Zachariah Sitchin, in which, no, he did not make this word up. The original word is A-N-U-N-A-G-I, Anunnagi. So, of course, in our language, it's Anunnaki. There are many scholars that have discussed this. If you would like a list of the scholars, you can look up George Smith, W.F. Albright. You can look at Samuel Noah Kramer, Sir Austin Henry Layard, Paul M. Albata. You can look up Jules Opert, and there's many, many, these are the men that translated these texts, and so it's quite interesting. So here we have Enuma Elish, tablet 6, 107, states, he, Marduk, shall be the shepherd of the Mesopotamians, his creatures. Of course, he's the Mesopotamian god, but he's the shepherd of his creatures. And in Hebrew Psalms 23:1, it says, the Lord is my shepherd. Then we have Enuma Elish, tablet 6, 131 and 32. 132, it states, creation, destruction, absolution, punishment, each shall be at his, Marduk's, command. Then we have Isaiah 45:7, which states, "The one forming light and creating darkness, causing well-being and creating calamity." Now, in this area right here with the Isaiah 45:7, in my Anunnaki gods, the god of Marduk, the god of Hammurabi, Cyrus, and the Israelites, question mark. This takes you right back to what I stated in my video about how the god over the empire was Marduk, and which I stated was the one who told Cyrus to go in to set the captives free in 539 BC. So Isaiah 45:7 right here in my other video is equated to Marduk. And I have specifically pointed out and have shown in that video how it actually all correlates as the same thing. And we all need to remember that the people during that time were held in captivity. And that was due to God sending them into captivity because of their disobedience. And where did he send them? He sent them to the learning center. And he sent them there. And the one who set them free was Marduk, according to Cyrus's cylinder seal. So here we have that verse. I suggest you watch the Anunnaki gods, Marduk, god of Hammurabi, Cyrus, and the Israelites, question mark. It's a really interesting video and is absolutely precise. So here we have in the Enuma Elish tablet 7, 151 through 152, it states that his Marduk's word is truth. What he says is not changed. Not one god has annulled his utterance. And in Numbers 23:19, it states in the Bible, has the Lord said and will he not do it? Or has he spoken and will he not make it good? So the word of him, Marduk, shall endure and not be forgotten. This is the Enuma Elish tablet 7, 31 and 32. And it states that the word of our God shall stand forever in Isaiah 48. They're still in Babylonian captivity right here. They're still there. Let them ever speak of his Marduk's exaltation, and let them sing his praises. Enuma Elish, tablet 7, verse 24. And in Psalms 21:13, it says, be exalted, O Lord, in your strength. We will sing and praise your might. So here we have them singing the praises of Marduk, and here we have in Psalms, they're singing the praises of the might of the Lord. In Psalms. In the Enuma Elish tablet 7, verse 120, it states, his Marduk's beneficent roar shall thunder over the earth. And in Job 26:14 and 37:2-3, it states, but his God's thunder rumbles from his mouth under the whole heaven, and his lightnings to the ends of the earth. Well, here we go. Marduk's beneficent roar shall thunder over the earth, and his lightnings to the ends of the earth in Job 26:14 and 37:2-3. Now, people need to remember that these gods, or this particular god right here, Marduk, came from the very beginning of the gods. He is one of the pantheon of 12 called the Elohim. And people need to recognize that in the Bible that there's the God of the Hebrews chose these people. And it was stated that they were to follow him, that he chose them. They did not choose him, he chose them. While the other nations during that time were over in the land of Ur and all these areas in Haran and in Nippur and all these areas where Anlil, the Lord and Prince of the air, the lord of the command, the lord of the wind, ruled, and so did his children. Now, Enlil's child is called Nannar, and he is the moon god Sin. So, these gods are not favorable to Marduk at all. They are against him. They war against him and everything. So God tells the people that he chose to be his and named them the Hebrews, that to follow him and follow him alone, and not to go after and serve the other gods by doing the same abominations that the other gods had implemented. So there's an understanding that these religious centers over in that area of Ur and were actually for Enlil's children, Shamash and Nannar and Inanna. These are his children, and they went through time, and they are the same exact gods through time that ended up over in Canaan, the land of Canaan. And I will get into this in another video to explain further. So here's the creation epic of Marduk and the dragon in the Enuma Elish, where it states that Marduk slays the dragon. And so in Enuma Elish, in tablet 7 and 74, this is where he is creating our solar system and the upper waters from the lower waters, just like it states in the Bible and everything. So it states, Marduk, who crossed the vast Tiamat, the sea goddess, back and forth in his wrath, spanning her like a bridge at the place of single combat. And so we have in Psalm 77:19 and Job 9:8, it states, thy way, God, was in the sea, and thy paths in the mighty waters. He, God, tramples down the waves of the sea. Now the sea represented Tiamat, the great dragon, and she was slayed. She became the earth. But anyway, I have a video on that creation epic called Rising of a New Dawn. It's just a short video about the creation epic and what it states in the Enuma Elish. I am going to be putting out the full 7 tablets on the Enuma Elish, and so I can get further with you guys so you can see what's going on here and how this has actually gone down through time and was placed in the Bible. And I have nothing against the Bible. The Bible is actually a parallel of the ancient text, and it's amazing. It's great that they recorded it with their culture, but people need to realize why they recorded it with their culture and where they were at the time that these things happened. So it states in Enuma Elish Tablet 7, 117 through 118, it states, he, Marduk, profound of wisdom, ingenious in perception, whose heart is so deep that none of the gods can comprehend it. And it states here in Job 9:10 that he, God, who does great things, unfathomable and wondrous works. Among the gods, there is none like unto thee, O Lord. And that is Psalms 86:8. These are the same types of things that is saying about the great God, the great Lugaldimmer Ankia, the divine king of heaven and earth, Marduk. This is him. It says, there is a writing in the religions of the ancient Near East by John Sturdy and also Helmer Rengren. And this is a book that you can find, the Philadelphia Westminster Press. It's 1973. On page 57, if you look it up, they talk about the gods, and they're discussing the Enuma Elish, but the Mesopotamians, like the Egyptians, held high god notions alongside crude polytheistic ones. So for instance, they have these prayers that exalts a Mesopotamian moon god, which is Nannar, which is Anlil's son. So his people worshipped him, and he was in Ur, and his religious center was in Ur, and you also have the religious center in Haran. So the moon god Nannar, or some call him Nana, I call him Nannar, he had these centers, and during that time, we have the story of Abraham, that Abraham was told to leave the centers in the land of his father, and his father's name was Terah. Well, if you look back in time, you'll see that the word Terhu, T-I-R-H-U, translates into a seer. So he was an oracle priest of the moon god Sin, and he was told by another god to leave the land of his father. So it states that Abraham went on and was left and was told to go into the land of Canaan. Like I said, I will get into this later. I just want you to recognize who this specific god is that I'm going to be reading to you right here. And it's Anlil's child. These are the same gods from the very beginning. So it states that in the text, it says, "Merciful, gracious Father, who holds all the life of the land in your hand, Lord, your divinity is like the distant heaven, like the broad sea, full of fearfulness, whose deep mind no god penetrates, the source of all things, who sees and protects all creatures, Lord, who determines the destiny of heaven and earth, whose command no one can alter. In the heavens, who is high? You alone are high. On earth, who is high? You alone are high." So that's out of the book of the religions of the ancient Near East. And that's, like I said, Helmer Rindgren and John Sturdy. But in the Babylonian epics, Marduk, instead of the moon god, attained the top status. He ended up taking upon the 50 names of the gods and usurped Anlil, because Anlil is a treacherous god that is stated in the Atrahasis that he sent the flood over mankind to destroy mankind. And Marduk's father is called Anki, and Anki is also known as Ea, which is Ea, E-A, and he saved mankind, and it states that he gave instruction through a reed wall, which is obviously some type and sometimes depicted as a, like, dimensional, some type of dimensional wall that he talks through to, you know, relate what he's saying. It's not a literal reed, but like a dimensional sphere to talk through, and gave him the tablets of the instructions on how to build the ark, and told him to gather animals. And this is in the Atrahasis, and people can read this, and this is much older than the Bible. This is the original and oldest creation epic that actually coincides with the biblical tales in the Genesis. So it's not as though the Genesis is a plagiarism. It's just another tale of the same story of the gods coming down through time, but they wrote it at a much later event. It's the same thing. Yes, they learned this information from the learning centers, and people need to realize that these places were filled with high technology. They knew the alphabet, they had mathematics, they knew astrology. I mean, it was just amazing what the Sumerians had. And so it all comes and stems from the beginning of civilization, which just became this glorious empire, all of a sudden knowing all these things, how to build these fantastic buildings. And so I'm, you know, this is what I'm going to be teaching, and I'll be teaching the cultures and the kings of the earth and everything. So it states that in a ritual that they'd have over in Babylon, they had a New Year's festival called the Akidu, and it was where Marduk was invoked in this fashion, where it states, my Lord is my God, my Lord is my ruler, and there any Lord is there any Lord apart from him? And you can look at Renegrin, and this is on page 110. And it also states that Nebuchadnezzar II prayed at his accession to Marduk. And it states that, everlasting Lord, master of all that exists, grant to the king whom you love and whose name you name all that is pleasant to you. Keep him on the right way. You have created me and entrusted to me the dominion over all peoples. O Lord, let me, according to your grace, which you pour over them all, love your exalted might and create in my heart fear of your divinity. So, in the Enuma Elish, Marduk is the trust of the land, city, and people. And the people shall praise him forever. At his name, the gods shall tremble and quake. Who administers justice uproots twisted testimony, in whose place falsehoods and truth are distinguished. Who uprooted all enemies, snuffed out all wicked ones. His name shall be the truth. This is Enuma Elish, tablet 6, 135 through 36, 146, and tablet 7, 39 through 40, 43, 45, and 54. So if you look up these tablets and you study what they're saying, it is talking about the same God.